Corinthians 13, the greatest gift. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became an adult, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. Welcome. My name is Gail Rubin, and I'm honored to be the celebrant for today's service honoring and remembering the life of Mary Adams. Today we speak with love about a woman who has touched our lives in so many ways. To avoid distractions of sounding brass or clanging cymbal, and to be fully present for our remembrance, may I ask, please silence your cell phones or electronic devices. Thank you very much. This is an important day when we stop to bear witness to a person's life and times among us, the difference Mary's living and dying made, and to reflect on our hope, our wonder, and our collected grief. It is a time to create a circle of support for loved ones gathered here. On behalf of the family, thank you for your presence here today. We are here in support of Mary's son, Michael, and her grandchildren, Devin, Gray, Ian, and Kayla, Mary's sister, Jean, and her children, David, Doug, Andrew, and Susan, and her husband, Jay. Mary said she wanted us to talk about her, not what she did. Yet so much of what she did is a reflection of who she was, a woman of many talents and interests, of intellect and activity. Mary Adams, born Mary Elizabeth Atchison, came from Irish stock. And we all know how well the Irish weave a story. She always had a twinkle in her eye. She was always ready to strike a dancer's pose. Not only could Mary tell a good story, she wrote stories. She listened to stories of family, of friends, of clients. She edited stories. Her life was a story of grand proportions. Mary said her family lineage came in the United States, stretched back to a forebear from Ireland who served in George Washington's army. And he very wisely married a lieutenant's daughter, which was a good career move and brought added benefits. Mary was born in Washington, Iowa. She came from a long line of farmers, the men, and teachers, the women. Her mother told her that she didn't have to be a teacher, because in the 1920s, when she was born in 1920, women got the right to vote. Well, Mary was a teacher, and she was so much more. She was a dancer, a reporter, an editor, an art curator, a publisher, a grant writer, a social worker, a clinical psychotherapist, an advocate for the underdog, a wife, a mother, a grandmother, a lover, and a friend. When Mary was a teenager, she spent a summer in Washington, D.C., and met Eleanor Roosevelt in person. If Mary wasn't already a liberal, she certainly was after that meeting. Throughout her life, she supported causes: the Southern Poverty Law Center, Doctors Without Borders, a number of veterans groups, and Native American tribes. Mary attended the University of California in Los Angeles. While pursuing her BA degree at UCLA, Mary was also active in dance and drama. And one day, while she was in the theater painting a set, Clinton Adams walked by. He looked at what she was doing and said, "You're doing that wrong." Thus started a romantic relationship and a professional partnership that lasted for 6 decades. They married while Clinton was on leave during World War II, and she held jobs almost everywhere Clinton's career took them. In the 1940s, when Clinton was in the Army Air Corps in Colorado Springs, Mary served as a Corps administrative assistant. In the early 50s, they went back to Los Angeles. With Clinton at UCLA, Mary was an elementary school teacher, an assistant at UCLA, and an assistant at the J. Paul Getty Museum in Malibu. In the latter half of the 50s, while Clinton worked at the University of Kentucky, Mary was a reporter for a radio station and for UPI, which is the United Press International Wire Service. They were in Gainesville, Florida when Michael was born, and she took some time off to be a mom. There was another jaunt back to UCLA in the early 60s, and then the call came. Mary and Clinton arrived in Albuquerque for their long association with the University of New Mexico. In 1962, Mary Clinton moved into a stunning California contemporary home on Morningside Drive here in Albuquerque. In this home, she continued to work to improve the lives of the less fortunate. She wrote and published books and articles, and she became a counselor and psychotherapist at the age of 57. Mary was a voracious news junkie. She was keenly interested in following and discussing politics. She loved political satire. We're talking about Tom Lehrer, and That Was the Week That Was, and more Rowan and Martin's Laughin', more recently The Daily Show with Jon Stewart, and Politically Incorrect with Bill Maher. Always the consummate hostess, Mary expertly made introductions and connections between people at her gatherings. Her winter solstice parties are legendary. And no matter what the day, cocktails were served at 5 o'clock. Hence the timing of our remembrance here today. Many famous artists visited Mary Clinton's home, and art was all over the house. A Matisse hung in the bathroom. I was always impressed by that. Georgia O'Keeffe was a friend, and Mary published several essays about her and other artists, and actually visited in Ghost Ranch, and Georgia O'Keeffe also came to the house a number of times. Mary lived in that home for 50 years, and on the sunny morning of March 8th, at the age of 91, with son Michael and sister Jean by her side, she peacefully died there. Mary was my next-door neighbor for the last 20 years, and there's now a hole in my heart when I look at her house. Truly, love makes a house a home. Mary was also a prolific list maker and used yellow sticky notes extensively. Back in September, she asked me to come over to meet with her and Michael to plan this service. We laughed together as we planned out her final party. What a gift this was. We knew how she wanted her life to be celebrated, and today those plans are reality. So let's hear some stories about Mary from her sister, Jean Wilson.
I'll start again. This is better. Mary was loving, generous, and empathetic, even as a child. When I came along, Princess Mary was dethroned. And that happens to firstborns whenever the next one comes along. To make things worse, I was a preemie, and I took most of our parents' time and attention for quite a while. She probably would have liked to smother me in my crib, but she resisted. The next few years, I was a whiny little brat, and I teased her. One day, Mother found her sitting in a closet crying. "What's the matter, Mary?" "I hit my little sister." And Mother said, "Don't cry, Mary. I wondered how long it was going to take you to decide to do that." Because of our age difference, we had different friends and activities, but we did play together quite a lot. In the winter, we built snow forts, had snowball fights, played fox and goose, went sledding together. We only had one sled. At the edge of the street in front of our house was a cement block about 2 feet tall and 6 feet long. There was an iron ring at each end, which had been for hitching horses prior to that. In the summer, it was a gathering place for the kids of the neighborhood. It was a base for hide-and-seek and Red Rover, a place for hopscotch and jacks between it and the sidewalk. After dark, all the kids gathered, and the older kids told ghost stories and scared us younger ones. The house we lived in was small. It had 2 bedrooms, so Mary and I shared a bedroom and a bed. Now, I was a quiet sleeper. Mary was not. I'd draw an imaginary line down the middle of the bed, and I'd say, "You stay on your side of the bed." But I'd wake up with her arm or her leg across my middle. Our dog slept in the basement, but one time we smuggled him into our bed and under the covers. When Mother looked for him, she opened the bedroom door and called his name, and he started wagging his tail and gave it away, so we didn't try that. Because of our economic situation, we rarely traveled outside the town, but when we did, or took rides in the car on a Sunday afternoon, Mother, Mary, and I sang and harmonized, and we did a lot of that at home. Dad was not much of a singer. Our mother's parents and siblings all moved to the West Coast in the 1920s. In 1937, Mother, Mary, and I visited our West Coast relatives. We stayed with 2 unmarried aunts who never went to the beach. They didn't know it was possible to sunburn in hazy sunshine, and there was no such thing as sunscreen lotion at the time. They took us to the beach, and we dived the breakers and played in the surf all afternoon. Got terribly sunburned, but we loved the ocean. The only relatives who lived in our town were a great aunt and uncle and their three unmarried daughters. They became surrogate grandparents and aunts. We always shared Christmas dinners, and when I was 10 and Mary 14, we got corduroy knickers and high-top boots and leather jackets for Christmas from them. Mm-hmm. And girls didn't much wear pants in those days. At Mike's request, as I was sorting Mary's mementos and some of Mother's which Mary had saved, I came across a snapshot of Mary and me in that attire playing in the snow. On each Memorial Day in the little town in Iowa where we lived, population 5,000, there was a procession from the town square 7 or 8 blocks to the oldest cemetery. That's where Civil War veterans and World War veterans were buried. School children, including Mary and me, carried flowers from our home gardens to put on the graves. Mary and I were really proud that our great uncle Alex, a Civil War veteran, and another Civil War veteran, the only other one in town, got to ride in an open car in the procession. Mary always was a role model for me. She was smart, sensitive, a voracious reader, often introspective. She talked to me about philosophy, religion, and the wider world. She told me many years later that at 12 she had decided she would be a Buddhist, but didn't dare tell anyone because we were raised in an anachronistic, rigid, rather strange form of Scotch Presbyterianism. And actually, those Irish, they came from Scotland to North Ireland, and that's why my son is bagpiping. A lot of them are Scotch. Mother told me this Scotch grandmother who came over after the family migrated would say, "Ah, there's no music like the Scotch." Like the bagpipe, she said. And then she'd say things like, "Oh, 9 o'clock and all's well and an Irishman drowned in the fly." Mary Glenn was valedictorian in high school. But I've continued to value her ideas, her opinions all my life. She was a valedictorian, but when I entered high school, she took me aside and she said, "Don't you be valedictorian. You have more fun than I did." And I did have. I did get to become valedictorian, but I did have a lot more fun. She played cello in the high school orchestra, and so I did when I got there. But we never had our own cello. It was school property. We both took piano lessons, but because of the Depression, our parents could no longer afford them. The piano teacher thought I had more potential talent, and she traded my lessons for shoes from Dad's shoe store. Mary had to stop her lessons and admitted to me many years later that she had really felt cheated. I was still often a tease. I would eavesdrop when a boyfriend brought her home from a date, and then I would mimic him when she came in the house. We were children of the Great Depression of the 30s. Our parents tried to shield us from some of the worries, but we knew, and Mary was especially aware, that Dad was in danger of losing his business, that we might lose our house. Money was terribly scarce. And so both of us, when we became teenagers, it was necessary to earn money and take jobs. Mary babysat, and then all through high school and junior college years, she clerked in McClellan's 5 and dime store. Though our parents both emphasized the importance of education, they could not afford to send Mary to college. She moved to LA, moved in with 2 aunts to establish residence, and commuted a long distance to UCLA. The second year, she moved into a cooperative dormitory, had a job in a UCLA office, but told me many years later that she really went hungry sometimes. She got a BA and MA degrees and then taught elementary school, as you've heard. The school was in a depressed neighborhood and she agonized over the bad family situations of some of the children. Mary had always wanted to dance, and so she did learn the ballet, and she did dance in some group, I don't know what it was, for a few years. And I recall she told me she met Clinton when she was painting a theater set, and the rest, of course, you heard. For many years, our jobs, our families, and geographic distance made it difficult for Mary and me to be together, But when we did get together, it was a real talk fest. I mentioned this to Michael recently. He said, boy, did you talk. Often it goes on into the night. In recent years, Mary and I have talked on the phone almost every day and saw each other whenever we could. And as you've heard, when J. Paul Getty started his museum in Malibu, he hired Dr. Valentino, who was retired from the L.A. Art Museum, to be the director, and he hired Mary to be his assistant. They got the original museum started in the large house on the Getty Ranch. In 1954, my husband, infant son, and I visited Mary in Clinton and went to the museum with Mary one day. It was then open to the public 2 afternoons a week by appointment. Mary gave us a tour of the museum and took us to the attic of the building, this old house, big house, where there were many rolled-up Persian rugs and all sorts of things Getty had collected. And we had a picnic lunch on the lawn, an area that's now occupied by the Getty Villa. In 1983, Mary, Clinton, Michael, Lynn, Maggie, Clinton's sister, and I rafted down the Dolores River. We went through forests, desert canyons, and camped at night. When we got to the largest rapids, named Snaggletooth, we pulled off to the bank, as had other rafters and kayakers, because the river was higher and the rapids more dangerous than previous years. Our boatmen scouted the river for a couple of hours and then decided to run the rapids. Many boaters were deciding to portage around, and Maggie decided to walk around, and Clinton agreed to go with her. Michael and Lynn were in the bow of one raft, Mary and I in the bow of the other. At one point, our raft was vertical, but didn't flip. Then the raft was filled with water, and we bailed water frantic. The boatman called us the Warrior Sisters, and I guess warrior was a term that was used for the people who did the bailing. Yeah, we all got out and eventually met up and celebrated at the toast of whiskey, as I recall. I'm so happy to have Mary as a sister. Loved her so much. I will miss her. But I was happy I got to spend time with her at the end while she was still able to communicate some. And was there, but since there was no good quality of life left, I was really relieved for her when she left us.
One of the people that Mary wanted to speak here today is Jim Belshaw. He's a former Albuquerque Journal columnist and a longtime friend of both Clinton and Mary. He was unable to attend today due to a family commitment. However, he sent me these words to share with you. So this is Jim Belshaw speaking. Mary and I talked about a lot of things, politics, art, journalism, psychology. We talked about UNM and the city and the state. We talked about her history and mine. We talked about her FBI sheet. I love the strange irony that this beautiful woman, who was exactly the kind of American America needed, being looked at askance by the FBI. I remember thinking that if the FBI, it made me think of all the times Tony Hillerman needled the FBI. I remember thinking that if the FBI thought it needed to investigate Mary Adams, then everything Hillerman said about them was right. Mary and I talked about Clinton and his art, and what made him the artist he was. We talked about her writing and mine. We went to lunch, or I came to the house, and we just let the conversation go wherever it wanted to go. Regardless of the subject or the location, I always left feeling that I had been given something. I always felt a little better because of the time spent with her. And here's something else that in my mind will forever be connected to those conversations. I always left her house either singing or humming the same song. There is nothing like a day in the world. There is nothing you can name that is anything like a dame. I don't know if Jim was planning on singing that, but I hope I did it justice. Dame is one of those generational words that you don't hear much anymore. I don't think I've ever used it in my life, except as it regarded one woman. Mary Adams was the best dame I've ever known. When I first met her, we spoke only in passing, usually when I was sitting at her dining table with seven other men who were playing poker when it was Clint's turn to host the game. It was only after Clint died in 2002 that the luncheons and visits with Mary began. I don't remember exactly how they started. I just remember only that I was glad they did. I suppose in the beginning I just wanted to see how she was doing. But it didn't take long before it became clear that I was enjoying the time I spent with her more and more. There were things I could learn from her if I was smart enough to pay attention. In 2005, I wrote a column about Mary and a long-distance relationship she had going with a man in Texas. It was a marvelous story about love, and it spoke to the irrelevance of age when you found yourself crazy in love. But before I wrote the column, I worried about the trolls on the internet, those poor empty souls who would write anonymous attacks for reasons that escaped me. I worried that they track her email down and fill her inbox with ugliness. So I told Mary I wasn't going to identify her or the man in Texas. Here's what she said. The nice thing about being old is you don't really give a damn what anyone thinks. So do it any way you want. We don't care. She was the best dame I have ever known. She made something inside of me sing. So this is me speaking now. The man in Texas was Donald Weissman. He was a college professor, a writer, an artist. After Clinton died, Mary found a 50-year-old photo snapped in New York, taken of her and Don. So their friendship went back many years. So she mailed this photo to him, and a late-in-life love story bloomed. And Jim Belshaw's column about them started out, so we're back to Jim Belshaw now. She's 84, he's 90. She lives here, he lives in another state. But they know how to get on an airplane, and so they have one of those long distance things going, you know? So Don had sent Jim a poem that Jim put into this column. And this poem is about Don's relationship with Mary. And it's called Let Me Tell You. So, Let Me Tell You by Don Weissman. Have you ever looked up the meaning in a big dictionary of the word home? You'd be surprised how richly varied and subject to ambiguity that word is. How it opens up a virtual vista through a little window. So let me tell you what I, a man of 90, after lots of loves, after three wives, all naturally dead and mourned, and children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, all living, let me tell you what has come to mean home to me. It means having the rare good fortune of falling freshly in love, deeply, body, mind, and soul, right now, and feeling her easy, open invitation, even as I open to her and we embrace. Let me tell you, it's like all the good was a series of markers telling me I was on the right road toward that embrace. And yes, at last, all the way home. He's 90, she's 84. They have this long distance thing going. We should all live so long. So thank you to Jim Belshaw for sharing his thoughts. Another great love of Mary's life is dance. And her good friend, Gigi Benahom, will now share some stories with us.
Thank you so much. It's really an honor to be here, as I'm sure you feel the same way. I am here to offer a little memoir of Mary the Dancer, a tribute to her wondrous spirit, her cheerful, unambiguous tolerance of some very difficult people, who shall remain unnamed, and her inspiring presence. Mary Adams was a person, as you've heard, of many talents and careers, a Renaissance woman in many ways. She danced, she played the cello, she was an educator, taught school, she was an astute editor. She raised money for important causes. She helped Clinton at every moment in his artistic development. She became a distinguished psychotherapist. She wrote a number of articles and books, and she curated, as you've heard, exhibitions. She's a wonderful example for our children and grandchildren. One of her marvelous contributions to fine arts was to help us found the University of New Mexico Friends of Dance in the late 80s. Hers was a frankly heartwarming commitment to talented dancers who needed financial help to make their way through school, giving them a boost on their way to the challenges of a dance career. And you can imagine how difficult that career is, even harder than being an artist painter. She came to all the meetings and was a great source of hope and energy. She and I were a kind of team, always going to the meetings together, sharing the day's silly events, our deep desires for our family and for ourselves, as we drove to various people's homes. Often she would muse upon her childhood, telling me that as a girl she gleefully listened to music, as her mother adored music and played the radio all the time. When someone who had a knack for dancing visited her family, she would ask them to teach her the latest dancing rhythms, and they were some rhythms. They were the Latin rhythms, they were the Black rhythms. In the 30s, you can imagine, it was a fabulous time. She mentioned a PE teacher in high school who was trained in modern dance in the Mary Wigmond technique, a famous dancer from the 30s and 40s. Imagine Mary Adams at 14 doing those very angular, dark, suffering moves, you know. But Mary adored tap dancing all her life and spoke very proudly of being a hoofer. In college at UCLA, Mary made the dances for a play, as you know. It was called Alice in Wonderland. And guess who designed the sets? Of course, you know very well who designed the sets. And then they came together, and the war quickly took over their lives. After the war, as you've heard, Mary taught school in Los Angeles and studied dance with a number of very well-known and important dancers. Harriet Gray and Lester Horton. There were some really famous, important, contemporary dance, modern dance people there. Always staying in shape, and these are her words, really, loving the freedom to express herself in movement. She told me a few years ago that what struck her about dance were the feelings of uplift and flow, that sense of openness, and the sense that you're flying and you're free. She said, my mother would move all the chairs, I guess Jean would remember, out of the living room to make space for my dancing and my feelings of freedom and being alive and the blood flowing that surges through you. All those Friends of Dance meetings, those cake sales, Mary cooked for us, believe it or not, potluck dinners after student dance shows. My husband dragged the tables and the wires, and the, oh my God, it was such a scene. These student dance shows were wonderful events, and it brought such a success to our organization, which remarkably has amassed, thanks in large part to the people of who came to these performances and who also supported us in other ways, We've amassed more than $150,000 in endowments, which is pretty good for our short history. So Mary, we know that like all Renaissance women, you are dancing with the angels and bringing joy with your nifty pixie self. Thank you.
So, speaking of dance, Mary was so proud of her granddaughter, Devon, a dancer since she was a little girl. And today we are honored to have Devon perform her dance, Oh My Soul, and this with psalm readers, her siblings, Ian, Gray, and Kayla. Shadow. We come and go like grass, which in the morning shoots up, renewed, and in the evening fades and withers. You cause us to revert to dust, saying, "Return, O mortal creatures." Would that we were wise, that we understood whither we are going. For when we die, we carry nothing away. Our glory does not accompany us. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. They quickly pass and we fly away. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Mark the wholehearted and behold the upright. They shall have peace. Lord, you redeem the soul of your servants, and none who trust in you shall be desolate. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Mary Adams' strength endured for 91 years. She was as sharp as ever, right up to the end. The work of her hands and mind and heart will endure in ways beyond our knowing. We affirm that her love endures in the lives she touched. Parents give us roots and give us wings. They bring us into the world, provide a foundation, and then give us the tools to find our own way. Though we may have grown up and grown away, there is still something special about sharing our victories and commiserating our defeats with that special parent. Even if the relationship might have been challenging at different moments, we never stray far from the promise that home is where the heart is. Losing a parent, even after a long and full life, leaves an empty place in our hearts. In spite of the darkness cast by this loss, we reaffirm our belief in the light of life. If you would like to join in the reading of the 23rd Psalm, the text is on the inside of your program. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The time is now 5:13 p.m. At Mary's house, that would mean it was cocktail time. Her favorite drink was a vodka martini with as many olives as she could get away with. Second place was Irish whiskey. There's an Irish ditty that goes, "There are many good reasons for drinking. One has just entered my head. If a man doesn't drink when he's living, how the hell can he drink when he's dead?" A special memorial gift for you. This cocktail napkin has Mary's name and date of birth and date of death, and a martini glass with two olives in it. And please take one or two as you leave. A friend of mine in the back of the room will be handing them out. And raise a toast to Mary and her memory as you enjoy your favorite beverage over the next few days. And let us finish our service with an Irish blessing. These things I warmly wish for you. Someone to love, some work to do. A bit of sun, a bit of cheer, and a guardian angel ever near. Mary Adams is now our guardian angel. Keep her memory burning bright in your heart. And keep telling her stories. As long as we remember the lives of those that we love, they never truly die. And now, as her nephew David Marshall plays Amazing Grace, please allow the family to exit first, and they look forward to greeting you outside the chapel. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you.